Everybody, welcome to 3D Vision BLG634E class. This is a doctoral level course in 3D dimensional vision. And I already told you, I assume that you guys took some at least introductory level computer vision or image processing course. We went through the syllabus. The syllabus is already in Ninova, so your course materials will be at our Ninova platform. Today, we will be doing an introduction, like a motivation. What are the problems? What are we trying to solve in 3D vision course? And the topic, it's still a very open, very much open research area. There is a conference, its top conference is, by the way, 3DV. If you guys are curious, you can look at, for instance, 3DV 2021 for relevant papers. Although this field is currently dominated by, dominated by deep techniques currently. Deep learning is the current trend in our field, in many of our data science AI fields. We require you to have the fundamentals, the mathematical fundamentals, the know the main methods in 3D vision, like camera parameters, camera calibration, homography, transform estimation, disparity estimation, and things like that. Therefore, we cover actually the classical 3D vision. However, at the close to end of the course, you guys will be in a position to apply your knowledge to learning-based methods too. That's why we will be actually covering, for instance, visual odometry, visual SLAM using deep methods. Then actually, for instance, after learning motion estimation, optical flow, you can actually easily utilize a deep learning based method that, for instance, incorporates optical flow constraints. Or we will learn about epipolar geometric mathematics, the fundamentals. Then you will see currently past 5 years, 6 years, now those epipolar constraints are inserted into deep neural networks so that we try to solve, for instance, correspondence matching and 3D reconstruction problems also. So Yusuf is, thanks to Yusuf, my assistant, he's just helping because he's my student actually. He has no official role here. So let's look at actually the motivation. First of all, I know you guys are already motivated about what, and you know the definition of the vision, but I can just still say, we as computer vision researchers, we are trying to, in a way, make the computers see, right? Teach the computers how to see, interpret visual data like we humans can do. So AI is this, artificial intelligence is this huge field, right? Where we try to teach the machines to learn to interpret this universe, this their surroundings. And actually vision is where we try to teach them to interpret just the visual part of the all this surrounding information. So, of course, I think its uses or being able to achieve artificial vision for humans will be a big advantage because we don't want to do, for instance, dangerous tasks. Maybe one example is these unmanned or unpersoned, let's say, vehicles, right? Important thing is they would be exploring disaster zones, right? Maybe earthquake zones where it's really dangerous to enter into buildings. Then with vision, artificial vision and drone technology, of course, we are able to, for instance, send in drones to the buildings and maybe do search and rescue, search for mines, and I'm trying to talk about humanitarian things. Unfortunately, there is also defense and war industry related uses, which I really don't like, but I mean, that's the fact of life. Of course, there are things like surveillance and again, self-driving cars, or for instance, in manufacturing, we try, there are human operators that look at the defects, right? Try to detect the defects in the manufactured parts. So those are repetitive, boring tasks. And current AI is actually becoming quite good in surpassing human performance, right? In those repetitive, well-defined tasks. Like I said, for instance, in manufacturing, defect detection, quality control, that's quality inspection also. One more humanitarian and more humanistic thing is augment humans with capabilities they lack. Maybe vision impaired people, helping them, right? There are sticks now for blind people or visually impaired people. Those sticks, they have cameras and they help those people navigate, for instance. And those are all based on vision technology, right? Artificial vision. So we will see, I mean, navigation, of course, robot navigation, obstacle avoidance, recognition, for instance. One of my students, Gülçin, for her, it was her graduation thesis, undergraduate, because in her family, she has visually impaired relatives. So she had this idea of actually taking pictures of Turkish banknotes, like 5 lira, 10 lira, 5 liras, 10 lira, 20, like 100, 200, and with a smartphone application, trying to actually classify those banknotes into, you know, whichever really banknote is that. Then that could be an application so that visually impaired people in their transactions, right, commercial transactions, could use, and they could avoid fraud, for instance, in that case. By the way, this is a note probably you've heard, Alan Turing's remarks. Alan Turing, we know, is one of the well-known scientists in computer science. This achieving human intelligence, similarly, this was also stated for computer vision, artificial vision, and artificial intelligence. In the 50s, those scientists wrongfully thought that it would be done just in a very short time, we would achieve that. And only thing that was an obstacle was processing power and storage capabilities. But of course, we know we are in 2022. We are still working, we researchers are still working in these things. So it's not that easy. I'm achieving human level intelligence, human level vision, those things require, I mean, those are really close to perfect systems, right? Our brain is the perfect intelligence system, the most intelligent, perfect object in the universe, probably, or entity in the universe. So as we know for now, so the actual surpassing it will take probably a considerable amount, or I mean, it's an open question. Also, you guys, some of you may argue, who knows? I mean, will we ever achieve it? I mean, these are more philosophical questions. So for us, we are trying to advance the technology, right? Make use of the current technology, the sensors. For us, for scientists like us, we are mainly using sensors, right? Sensor devices. And in vision, of course, those are visual data. And you guys, if you are working in vision, you are actually devising the algorithms for this computational device. So we receive the data, visual data, and we extract information. If you worked on 2D vision before, you extracted features. You did image processing, work with 2D images, maybe 3D images, but still You worked extract on recognition of images, segmenting images, maybe not 3D structure, so it's going to become clear. So there is information extraction as the first step, and there is interpretation of that information as the next step. What is the overall goal, guys? I mean, why am I extracting features, right? Or why am I recognizing objects? I'm using those representations to, for instance, know what I'm dealing with, which surroundings, where am I in the world? How can I navigate? How can I go from point A to B, right? I want to do planning, strategic planning, for instance. You guys may be hungry now, and you may have already started planning where you will eat your lunch today, right? In that, while doing that, you are visualizing, like, for instance, you go to the cafeteria, and you guys already know how to go there, both, of course, by cognitive processing in your brain and during the action. Maybe you're visualizing that before you go. Sometimes we do that. Or as we set out on that journey, of course, we make use of our excellent human vision capabilities and interpretation and cognitive actually understanding capabilities. So those are the ultimate goals, of course. That's why we do all this sensing, extracting information, processing information. So in 3D vision, guys, the main goal is extraction of 3D information, and actually that leads to recovering or extracting or coming up with 3D representations of the world, because we live in a 3D world. Of course, if you also add time, space-time, it's a 4D world, basically. At each time frame, in a static frame, time point, we can think of it as a 3D scene, right? 3D surroundings. So we're trying to really extract that 3D, extract and express that 3D representation of the world, which would be, of course, immensely useful to us in our intelligent processing. And of course, we do that as humans. It will be useful to us in our artificial intelligence tasks, right? And decisions, cognitive processing of all kinds of information, and then reasoning, making plans, I was saying, right? Making decisions is like deciding what to do next, for instance, is all actually the ultimate goals, all kinds of goals we have. So to do that, we do all these pre-processing. For instance, this is a statue. And here is actually this statue is something, let's say, physical, maybe, or this is a cup, right? This is a cup. We take pictures. These are, you see, pictures around the object. Actually, your final project will be this. We will give you pictures of a statue from ITU, our campus, beautiful campus, and also a building, I believe. We will be gathering that data soon, in the coming weeks, guys. And you guys will be reconstructing to us as your final project, for instance, 3D object like this, okay? That I think that will be fun. You will make use of all this information or knowledge you are gaining in this course. So that's one goal. Use these multiple pictures, 2D pictures, and come up with this 3D representation. Also, for instance, from images, look at this living room image here up there. We also may want to just come up with another 2D map. This was a 3D object we came up with here, but this is a 2D map, depth map. This is also a 3D information. Extracting this depth map, meaning, for instance, the sofa is close to me, right? The windows are back. Let me see what else is there. There is wall, I think, right? There is a wall here, and then there is floor, of course. So this tells us, getting this depth information, of course, helps us navigate the world, avoid obstacles, to measure distances. Actually, again, with our excellent human visual system, when you look at such a fixture, you can guess, right? Like how far is the, I mean, you don't need to look at this picture. I'm showing, look around yourself currently in your room. You can, what you call gauge the distance, right? Get an estimate of the distance between you and the table, your monitor, your sofa there, back there, and other things, the wall. This is all your 3D vision capabilities, okay? There is also, like I'm showing here, LiDAR data, 3D data, point cloud data, which is this time obtained by LiDAR camera. I'm going to talk about that. It helps us, again, navigation, obstacle avoidance. We sometimes create, as you see here, panoramic pictures, that is stitching multiple pictures you take from a scene together. That's a topic we will be studying. And then with these 3D models, other things are, for instance, that you can do in 3D vision is separate them into parts, because maybe you want to do 3D action recognition and thing, or deformation of these 3D models. And one thing is, once you extract such a 3D model, for instance, here, there was a toy like this here, and you insert that model, you create this model, and you insert it into your video, for instance, your scene. This is how these augmented reality movies are done, or fully computer graphics animated movies, CGI movies, right? This is an artist or those graphics people working on creation of the, for instance, the models that will be used in those movies, actually, okay? Here at this point, I can mention the relation of vision to graphics. If you don't know, this is important. Guys, what we call graphics is the forward process of vision, meaning there is a 3D object, right? Like this, or as in here, you see this toy object here. It's a model object, right? We create actually its renderings. We create, of course, a 3D model of it in the computer digital environment first, and then we forward project it onto 2D, right? And we can render this. Once I have its 3D model, I can render it from all directions, actually, meaning I can create these 2D pictures from different viewpoints looking at the same scene. This is forward imaging, image formation. This is how objects, 3D objects, give rise to images or construct images. This is 3D to do 2D. And here is obviously, or apparently, loss of information, right? We're losing one dimension. We're coming from 3D to 2D. Now, computer vision is the inverse problem of image formation. We're coming back from 2D to 3D. We're trying to. Our goal is to come back, come from 2D formation to 3D. That's why actually vision is a difficult problem. We try to recover some lost information, okay? And that's why it's called ILPOS, because already that lost one dimension coming from 3D world to 2D, we're trying to really infer it back, okay? That's why vision, we typically believe vision is a difficult problem, but of course computer graphics has its own challenges, like real-time rendering, realistic rendering, for instance, also forming very realistic 3D models. So that's also, I mean, its difficulties are different, its complexities. So the fundamental problem, hopefully at the end of this course, you guys will be quite knowledgeable in this. The main problem of 3D vision is, guys, there was some object, 3D object in the 3D real world out there, physical world, like this cup again. And we took its pictures from different viewpoints. You took your camera, right? Now our smartphones all have these beautiful cameras. So I am taking pictures of this, right, from different viewpoints. So those are 2D images like here. And your goal will be just looking at these 2D pictures using how to recover the 3D geometry and plus the photometry of the scene for better rendering, of course. Guys who asked, so for this course, During my explanation and of these topics, we will assume the features are given first, because you know there are so many different problems we're trying to solve. Exactly, guys, like Abdullah asked, for instance, here, what are the features we're talking about? Look at this corner of the window, right? We have to, in order to actually recover the 3D geometry of the scene, meaning 3D coordinates, right, of the scene point. This is a 3D point. I'm showing, do you see my mouse, guys? Yes. We have to locate these features, important features like corners, important meaning locatable and correspondable features, meaning in this picture, this camera was looking at the scene from a different viewpoint. This is, for instance, a different viewpoint. This same feature, this same corner of that same window, I have to be able to locate, okay, exactly, and also match, meaning corresponding features should be also found. So there are actually two challenging steps to 3D vision, like your friend asked. First is feature extraction and also feature matching, meaning try to label those same features across these views. Okay, and then the next part is recovering the camera poses, for instance. Okay, but where are those cameras in this 3D world? Those are rotation translation parameters of the camera, focal lengths of the camera, or different cameras if these are, okay, for instance, lens distortion parameters, if there is skewness, curveness parameters of the camera. So that's why the problem is difficult. We need corresponding features in multiple perspective images, meaning because we will be modeling this forward image formation, right? That is, I call projective equivalently perspective projection, right? 3D to 2D. And that's one huge step of vision problem, feature extraction and matching. And then we have to do camera calibration, camera pose estimation. Then we triangulate, we have to do scene structure or 3D reconstruction, structure reconstruction. Is the problem, main problem clear, guys? Yes, great. This is the main problem of 3D vision, most classical important problem. We will be learning about this in this course. That's why you see I'm not really skipping directly. I could have changed the course to full deep learning, deep methods, but also in my undergrad computer vision, if some of you took it, you guys know, I haven't changed that to deep learning or learning based, because first we have to learn the classical, fundamental, mathematical underlying methods of vision, then learning based methods can come on top of that. Okay, good. Thanks. You guys are following very well. So guys, the important problem here is, of course, first, we don't know which features to extract, how to match them. Second is we do not know the viewpoints from which the images were taken. Okay. Also, some of the other camera parameters, such as the focal length, is also unknown. We have to estimate all of these. All right. So guys, here comes, I was showing multi-view there. Here comes the stereo view, stereo vision problem. And actually, because I was telling you this human intelligence, right, human visual system, they are, I mean, close to perfect. I mean, the most amazing object or creation entity, whatever you want to call it, in the universe, probably currently, as we know it, it is. Again, away from the philosophical questions there. So that's why as scientists, right, we try to mimic, simulate what the human intelligence is doing. Also in this case, stereo vision is, as scientists, vision scientists, we came up with stereo vision because we know humans, right? We are using stereo vision, meaning this is also called stereopsis, guys. The that means we have two views, right? Just a sec, let me close you guys. So we have two sensors, I mean, two cameras in a way. And we actually perceive depth, right? by the fact that due to the fact that those two cameras or sensors are placed a little bit apart, right? That's what is called stereopsis. We perceive depth due to receiving the information from the same scene, but through two different cameras displaced by some certain amount. Okay, this is also called binocular vision. So from two separate cameras, we can do this, like our eyes, and also, for instance, in 3D movie acquisition, and also I'm gonna show actually some slides on that, and projection, that idea is used. Or we can also use a single camera here, take the scene picture, translate it, and take the scene picture. So those are two possible things. Of course, I'm talking about stereo, two-view geometry. That's the basis, right? The fundamentals. Then that is also extended to multi-view geometry. Okay. And like we've seen, finding matches or correspondences between images is a key technology or technique here we have to master. Because then, by the help of those also, we will actually figure out relative distance of the object from the camera, the depth. I mean, depth can be tied to disparity. What is disparity? That's the distance between the two cameras, okay? I was already saying this by the eyes, guys. This is, let's check this. I think, yeah, there was just a, you know, search stereopsis or binocular vision. This was the first thing that comes to, you know, as the first site. It talks about stereo vision and say we have these two cameras, right? And looking at, let's say, this scene, this is a set of, I don't know, not bottles, let's say, right? And they are, you see, with the help of our binocular vision, we can infer some depth, right? That there. I mean, it's more easy to infer depth. You can, of course, say, even if I close one of my eyes, I can infer it, but it's because your brain already learned that from before, from your past experience. But with the help of two views, actually, you can even make some estimate measurements and really navigate the scene, or make actually the inferences about this scene, right? Without even going there. I can see, for instance, there are one, two, three, four bottles at least, right? In a like ordered way. This white one is the closest to me. And you see, because my eyes are like about 5 centimeters apart, so they are really looking at the scene from two different viewpoints, right? And we will be learning this exactly, how to then recover. So we will teach the machine in a way, our computer, to really recover that 3D information by using those two pictures that were taken through a stereo camera, for instance. And then we can say where the objects are in relation to our bodies and in relation to each other, with much greater precision, as it says. So if you've been to, have you been to a 3D movie where you used these special glasses, guys? 3D theaters, I'm sure you've been there. Maybe at least one, maybe. They use this stereoscopic 3D. Guys, this is, for instance, a camera that takes a 3D movie, captures 3D movie. This is how they record them. You see two lenses here, two cameras like our eyes, similar to, and especially they are designed so that those two cameras are like separated, similar to the distance of our eyes. Because then when we actually, when this is recorded through two cameras, guys, with two different polarizing filters, that's more optics actually. So one is horizontally polarized, one is vertically polarized. Then actually the projectors of these movies, 3D movies, are, you see also two of them. You can see two projectors. So one of them is projecting the video from one of the cameras here, the other is from the second one. Then when we put on actually a glass, 3D glass, Actually, two of those camera movies are at the same time projected there. And with the help of the actually filters in those glasses, guys, nice thing is one of the eye receives actually only the video from one of the cameras and the other one receives video from the other. So it's really exactly doing this 3D reconstruction, helping us do the 3D reconstruction in our brain. I mean, it's a very ingenious idea, very nice idea. Is this idea clear? That's how we perceive 3D depth in 3D movies. Of course, we would need, you can see actually two different pictures are on top of each other here, right? You see the shift, the disparity. Başka çeşitleri de var. This is the most original, basic one. I think linear, vertical polarization, horizontal, but I think they have circular polarizing ones too. But this is a little bit more advanced optics and stuff. What is your comment, Abdullah? All right. So, guys, major areas in vision, we can say. There is, so like I said, in this class, we are concentrating on the space geometry part mainly. Okay, the colors are not great, but okay, object shape recovery, depth estimation, 3D scene reconstruction, we will be concentrating here. Then there is also the semantics and learning parts. There is also 2D classical parts, image processing related part. And then there is also like this more machine learning related semantic learning part. So we will be, like I said, especially on the space geometry recovery. Let's see. Okay, I mean, mixed examples in from both domains. Of course, face recognition, facial expression recognition. I'm sure you've seen this example. Object detection and classification. Now, deep neural networks are really great at this, becoming, I'm not great, but quite good. This is a Kinect camera. Actually, I'm going to talk about this. Now you can do augmented reality. There are cheap like Xbox or right Kinect cameras where you can buy and create 3D actually representations of objects and insert them into your scene. So this is, you see 2D, 3D is becoming mixed. Exactly, this is the augmented reality I'm talking about. I have a few more slides on that. There is another field, which is medical imaging, for instance, where you deal with both 2D, 3D images, because medical imaging deals with the imaging of the anatomy, right? Human body, which is 3D, of course. So it tries to reconstruct organs, anatomical entities, structures, and functions and structures. It's trying to understand through medical images. Okay, so for the space geometry, object recovery, shape recovery, actually, guys, there are time of flight cameras like this Xbox Kinect. These are time of flight cameras, meaning, you know, the sonar and radar, right? Sonar sends sound waves, right? The ships use it a lot in the sea environment, oceans, sound waves, and it gets, for instance, it hits objects in the surroundings and gets reflected. And due to the sound speed and the reflection time, you know, the amount it takes to come back, you can come up with an idea of, you know, what objects are out there, some scene or surrounding geometry, similar to the radar. In that case, you send radar waves. Here, with this Kinect type camera, time of flight camera, you use infrared lights. These are laser, actually. You've seen this. Also LiDAR, it's laser. It sends this time light waves. They are invisible to our eyes and it hits the objects. And again, due to using speed of light and the amount of time it takes to go and bounce back and come back to us, to an object, we can come up with a point cloud, for instance, a scene representation, actually, with this time of flight cameras. We can measure distances, volumes. We can use them for instance, object detection. This is a LiDAR camera output example. once we started detecting objects, then we can do classification on them. We can actually do navigation, right? Avoid obstacles here. And actually, you see, it helps us navigate our surroundings. It helps us like know where we are and what where other objects are. And then it makes us, helps us make planning, how to move, right? Make a decision, how to make a safe move or navigation in this scene. And that was the space geometry part, right? Now in the semantics and learning, if you include that on top of this, now we can, you see, start doing classification, recognition of objects. Hey, there is a building here. This is a pedestrian. There is a car, you see. Now we started labeling things, right? That is, we started giving semantic meaning to the objects or detected structures in the scene. And then also that helps us understand the scene, right? Understand and interpret the scene. So I hope these two sides are clear. Okay. Another important visual cue is flow, of course, like motion. We will be studying this. We will be actually estimating 2D motion. For instance, this was a moving camera object, a moving scene. Here, this was, I think, a zoom out camera motion. From that video, I'm not showing the video. I think this was from a paper. So you see, you can extract a depth map, like what is, which object is in front of the other. And for instance, you can extract here an optical flow, which really shows the camera motion, actually a zoom out camera motion. Also with motion, of course, we can do feature tracking. So tracking objects and extracting trajectories of objects. There is also another thing, which is called scene flow, which is this time trying to estimate the real 3D motion. First, we extract 3D objects. So you need actual this time extraction of the 3D structure and also over time. So it's 3D plus time. It's a 4D data. You try to estimate the 3D motion, which is called also scene flow. That's after this class what you can do with. Okay, structure from motion is exactly actually as what this slide says here. There is a moving camera, for instance, it's moving just looking at this object. That's a building, big building. And like you guys asked before, you try to extract the corresponding or the same point from the scene. Look at this green dot, guys. That's a specific corner of this building. Now in your moving camera, you try to extract, for instance, it was visible here. But it's not also, you have to know, it's not visible in the other scenes. For instance, this cyan or red, actually, let's say red corner is visible here, here, here. So actually you start matching these points. With that, that's input, images with features extracted and the correspondences. That's the input to this algorithm, structure from motion. Output is 3D location for each point of these points. Okay. Typically, it's not dense. There is some interpolation. There is something called what we call a bundle adjustment. We minimize the reprojection error. But of course, we have to also estimate the here camera pose, camera motion, and things like that. I'm trying to give an overview. Visual odometry also is very similar. So visual SLAM, actually visual structure from motion, very similar things, because here it's maybe like a single camera that's moving. Maybe with visual odometry, actually your goal may be really trying to recover only the trajectory of the camera. So that's the difference from SLAM. So in SLAM or SFM, structure from motion, you try to cover both camera pose, position and orientation, like here you can then draw the trajectory of the camera, plus here we also come up with a 3D structure of the scene. In visual odometry, actually all we care is this camera is moving in a scene, We try to only estimate the camera location. So what we call camera pose actually, rotation and translation, okay? And here there are problems such as loop closure. While you are drawing this trajectory, guys, you try to also see whether when you are going back to the same scene again, is this loop really closing? I mean, these are still open research issues, by the way, visual odometry, visual slam. That's why that's not textbook knowledge. After learning all the fundamentals, close to the end of the course, we study a few papers actually on this one. The textbooks, I can give you reading, but those textbooks also talk about some current studies actually. We try to establish a mapping from 3D to 2D. And 2D to 3D, of course, okay? That's a scene, and that's a picture of the scene. But here we would need to know, look at the camera position, guys, here. We should know where the camera is. That's called camera pose or its other parameters, okay? This is called, by the way, also passive 3D reconstruction or triangulation. If I know the camera parameters, for instance, here, then I can actually triangulate back, for instance, for this, and I know these features, where they are in the 2D images, and if I know where my camera centers are and how they are, so that is how they are located, right? Their translation with respect to a world frame, reference frame, coordinate frame. This is my camera frame one, camera frame two. If I know where these cameras are situated in the 3D world now and their rotations also, I can actually send rays back to 3D space that will pass through the same point in these two views, right? The same feature point. And then I can really find the 3D coordinate of this same feature point in the this time on the 3D structure up there. This is 3D reconstruction by triangulation, of course, of the matched pairs. This is passive because we're looking at two views, camera views that were already acquired from two optical cameras, for instance, and try to triangulate back. There is also another field called active vision. This is structured lighting. You send a known light pattern to the scene. For instance, here, this is, let's say, really a line-like light, this laser sends a red light. And this is the scene, for instance, you see that metal frame which makes a curve there. And you see this time you have a light source, that's a structured light source and a camera. Camera is viewing what is illuminated by this light. You see, this is the picture. And then because we know the pattern, like it's a light source, it's red, now actually capturing correspondences and 3D structure becomes a little bit easier, observing geometry of that pattern that we know of via camera. This was, guys, in 2009 or 2000s, early 2000 to 2010, very active research field. Stanford had a big project on this. They went to Italy, Rome. They said these important Roman statues, we want to reconstruct them by structured lighting. This was a big expensive project. They set up all these cameras, did hours of scanning. You see exactly the setup I was talking about. This light source, the laser, is sending, you see here a light pattern, and then the camera is picturing it. And actually they obtained model of this entire, it was a 5 meter statue. This David, the statue of David, and they were able to really obtain good, very good 3D views. But now, this was like now more than 12 years ago. So that was during the time. It's not up to date. You would have to check what the situation is there. But this is the structured light. For instance, this is a little bit more complicated light pattern. So one of the cameras emits the light. So here it's still looking like a stereo view, you see. But in this case, one on the left is a camera. You see the right one, this is a light emitting object, actually light emitter, I mean light source. So this guy emits this pattern on the scene, 3D scene, you see, and we image it. Now, for instance, I know there are two pink lines there, right? So I know how to really relate this view, this pattern, and it's on the image can be more easily related. So this triangulation can be done much easily because correspondence problem can be solved much more easily because I know exact pattern that I'm projecting onto the scene. Okay, so that was the idea. But this big project was from years ago, but still actually this is a valid 3D reconstruction idea. Also, there are techniques that talk about single view. What is called metrology is like estimate depth from a single view, so properties of the world, but this is a little bit, prone to error. I mean, there are techniques. We also in my group worked on this depth estimation from single images. How to resolve that scale ambiguity is still a problem there. You may not be really resolve some of the uncertainties or ambiguities. Still, for a 3D reconstruction, multiple views is a preferred choice. Like I said, hopefully in this course, your final project or course project, let's say, the whole term project involves you reconstructing 3D structures from multiple views, okay? So this will be the idea, okay. What is the input there? It is hopefully, if it's not calibrated images, what is calibrated image? Meaning you know where the cameras are. Cameras, we will see, have two kinds of parameter set, intrinsic and extrinsic parameters. Extrinsics are where these cameras are located in 3D and how they are oriented. You see the camera centers here and their orientation we have to estimate. Those are camera extrinsic parameters. And intrinsics are the other parameters like focal length, skewness, and lens parameters, mass distortion parameters. Here, output is the 3D object model, okay? Typically, first we get a point cloud, guys, and then, let me see, we have used some computational geometry or computer graphics methods to mesh, to move them to triangulated meshes and also to texture map on top of those. That is the topic of not the 3D vision, you know, this texture rendering and stuff. We can use tools for them, but that's not our research field. That's computer graphics and computational geometry. Okay, so for instance, Google Maps and Google Earth make use of this technology. Oh, this is a nice rendering, by the way, of this multi-view stereo reconstruction. You see they fly all these drones. They put people on the streets of every city, by the way, in the world, probably without even getting like permissions, they've done this. Because I know even for Istanbul, they have these. And they can reconstruct terrain and buildings and all these 3D structure of the cities. But maybe you can say also another opinion here is somebody should do it, right? And these guys already did it, which is fine. Right? Currently the privacy, you know, data owning, ownership, those things are more important. But at the beginning of these technologies, maybe 5-10 years ago, it was more freely, easy to acquire all these things. So that was my point, actually. This was also a project, well-known project, a few years past, maybe 7-8 years ago, phototourism. These people, this project said, for instance, if you're visiting Rome, there are thousands of tourists, right, taking pictures there. So send us or just collect these in a database. This form this large collection of images and then automatically compute actually each photo's camera location and pose each viewpoint and try to create actually then relate, meaning do a correspondence matching with all these, between all these thousands of views and do a 3D reconstruction. For instance, this was Colosseum in Rome, to do a 3D reconstruction of that from these large collection of photos. You can just visit the site and check this project. I didn't have other or the big visualization. That was actually, I think, one of the pioneering projects of this large scale multi-view reconstruction, guys, which is fine, which is fun. So maybe our project from ETU campus will be, look a little bit like this. I mean, it won't be thousands, but maybe tens of images you will try to you will use and try to reconstruct the scene. Also, there are other things, applications. For instance, this was my actually undergrad and master of science student, Rıza Alpgüler. They have this technology, dance pose, currently last year acquired by Snap. Actually, currently Alp works for Snap because his company was acquired by the big Snapchat. So their technology was real time with a smartphone through video, capturing human body, the pose, the only the torso, face, or you know, head, or the whole body actually, and come up with, let me see, it doesn't play. You guys can go and check and map that 2D photos to a 3D surface representation. So U and V coordinates, they had a special representation. So that was a real-time 2D to 3D mapping, which was really very successful, one of the first. Important thing here is then you can actually take your own photo, create your 3D version, and you know, do augmented reality, do deformations, you know, put yourself into other scenes and do action analysis, maybe even put some clothes on top of you and see yourself in 3D. So many vision and commercial applications. That's why actually they were grabbed, acquired by this big Snap, actually. We will do this application, guys. So this is a simple illustration. This picture is one camera taking this, this building photo. Then you move a little bit or with another camera, doesn't matter. Or it could be the same camera displays. Take the picture of this building you see from another viewpoint. Now estimate the transform between them. Actually, without going to 3D, we can estimate something called a projective transform and come up with this panoramic, or what we call mosaiced image. Okay, you see, without a 3D reconstruction, we try to in a way utilize this projective geometry or encoded 3D underlying information to enhance our understanding of the scene, right? 3D scene, because we are now able to look at the scene from a wider viewpoint, right? Instead of analyzing these two views separately, we can analyze this through a single picture. And I think most of you know our cameras have this capability of panoramic stitching. Our smartphones, I should say. They have cameras and there is a panorama. I think in most of you have tried this probably at least once, right? And here actually for stitching these, you need to do correspondence matching, of course. I was telling you also, you can do augmented reality, even basic augmented reality, because now you have videos, right? You can also with now LiDAR cameras are even becoming in smartphones, create some object, take some object in your environment, create its point cloud or 3D model and insert it into another video of yours, okay? Here the thing is it's a moving scene and you have to do real-time estimation of the video or your camera actually, its movement in time, right? And Then you have to, of course, align that object while you are inserting into that scene. So you can do augmented reality homemade movies even now yourself. And I think there are, in the past years, I've seen one app like this. You were able to, for instance, this is your video. It's on the road, or this was how the Jurassic Park is actually, movie is acquired or done. You take the, or you actually acquire or record your movie and then insert these 3D objects of dinosaurs, right? Here, this app was a smartphone app. You can take a T-Rex or some other dinosaur, like here, this is, I believe, some other type, maybe Allosaurus, because my daughter liked them when she was a kid. I recall this is, for instance, a plant eater. One, this is, of course, T-Rex. You can insert this into your own video you took with your smartphone, actually, right? This requires 3D vision capabilities of. Okay, actually, I think these slides are going into too much detail. We will, you will study this, but what is disparity? Guys, just maybe do this. Now, put your thumb like this. Okay, I want you, all of you, to do this now. Close one of your eyes. Okay, you are still, stay still. Close, for instance, your right eye. Then open that, and this time close your left eye. Just do this consecutively. Do you see the amount of shift in the place of your thumb? Can you see that? That's called disparity. That's the distance between actually those two views. And also now what you should try is put your thumb away. Now do the same experiment. Compare this, bring it here. How does that disparity, the movement in the location of your thumb changes? Can you observe that and tell me? First of all, so disparity is inversely proportional to depth. You guys figured it out. So we we estimate disparity, and then try to estimate depth. So also that's one idea, one thing we will be studying. So also what we will be seeing is we will place these two views. Normally they can be in any viewpoint, right, in space. But we have something called rectification, stereo rectification. We bring those, we rectify them so that their planes, the image planes, are parallel to each other like this. And then actually by just measuring the disparity between the two points that are coming from the same scene point, right? Two feature points match. We measure the disparity between them, like here, this D, which is X minus X prime. And then depth will be really inversely proportional to disparity. That's depth estimation, actually, one idea of depth estimation. So here, like you guys asked, what finding correspondences is one of the major actually steps of the 3D vision. Because if you make an error there, your algorithm, right, your all of the results are messed up. So for instance, here, this is a phone, you see, desktop phone here. This is the corner, you see, bottom right corner. Now, this is actually a camera, either a camera has moved or it's a stereo camera, two views, it's two different views looking at the same scene, right? So the question is, finding correspondences question is, if I just pick the point like X here, you guys see this on the left image, where is that in the right image? That's X prime. I have to locate that. Of course, it's not going to be in the same place. I mean, camera has moved, right? I mean, if this was, let's say, 128 by 95 pixel location, of course, it will be much different here, right? So we have to find that. Here, I mean, of course, brute force, you have to search and do match all over the image, which is, of course, crazy. What we do is we use something called epipolar geometry. This is something you will learn. We know because the corresponding points, X prime, if we picked X, right, in one of the views, the corresponding x prime should lie on this epipolar line. So if we can set up this epipolar geometry between the two views, we will be searching only along the epipolar line. So learning about this epipolar geometry and using that to recover the camera positions and then doing 3D reconstruction is one of the fundamental topics of this course. Okay, so we learn about this. I shouldn't probably go into many more details here because this is a topic of a week on its own. Okay, but the thing is, we know by through the epipolar geometry definitely know that the corresponding point for x on this left image should lie on this green line on the right image. So one of those x1 prime, x2 prime, or one of those possibilities is really the real match. Okay, so the search space is really reduced. You see, from the whole 2D image, it's reduced to one line. For instance, let's see. For instance, this is a corner point of this. You see, I'm trying to pick rich points, expressive feature points. If you pick, for instance, a point like this on this homogeneous region, how do I know? For instance, let's say, do you see my mouse, guys? This is a very uniform part of this desk. How do I find where that is here, right? It's impossible to do the matching. That's why we pick feature-wise rich expressive points. So that means they are repeatedly found. They are easy to match at least on the other image. So for instance, this top right corner of this monitor, to find that, okay, I would have to search on the corresponding epipolar line, this sky, which is this orange, light orange or yellow line, right? And this would be the, I mean, of course, probably somewhere around here, pixel wise, it may be really difficult to exactly pinpoint, but still we can do a really good match. But again, I tell you, the most of the, or at least the major part of the course, we will assume correspondences are given, but for your final project, we don't. But actually at the features week, we will talk about feature extraction and matching. So, okay, until then, to study the 3D geometry, we will assume feature points are given and matches are given because we are dealing with many other difficult things already, okay? Okay, so I think I've already said that, and these are some other examples for matching related points. You see, this is actually quite a different viewpoint. Look at these top two views here, guys. For instance, the mouse, the center of this mouse button here, and here it is. It was in the corresponding, it should lie on the corresponding epipolar line, right? And then these are the rectified views. They were made parallel to each other so that actually those epipolar lines become horizontal. Okay, that is the idea here, image rectification. Normally, if my cameras are looking at the scene from these two different viewpoints, you see oriented in arbitrarily in 3D space, we make them coplanar, align them. And that's why when the search for correspondence is simplified to one dimension, meaning just along rows in an image, which is excellent. And then actually we can, once we find that, we can really look at the amount of shift between, for instance, this guy, you look at this guy here, this point, it was here, right? Now this is the disparity amount. It has become, now it has shifted to here, that's the disparity. And depth is really proportional to, I think it's coming up to some focal length and one over this part, I think, let me see. Ah, okay, it's coming up here. I mean, this is, we will study these. So guys, I mean, this is a little bit too many details, but to give you an overview. So once you know disparity through similar triangles, we can come up with, so here x left minus x right is the disparity, okay? B is the baseline, the distance between two camera centers. Z is actually what we are trying to recover, the depth. And we should know the focal length of the cameras. So if we know these other parameters, camera parameters and the disparity, we can come up with the depth, for instance, okay? Relative depth. So what else did we have in between? Let me see. Okay, this is really, like I said, upgrading from disparity to depth. If you're interested, you can look at this video, disparity depth map. I think they were doing it in real time, and we will be studying this. So this is a little bit, probably too many details at this point. So summary of what I've just said, we want to infer representation of the 3D world, but after we hopefully, faithfully somehow recover the 3D representation, it serves our other purposes, right? Like it facilitates, like I said, answering questions for us, for our higher level cognitive processing. For instance, like I was saying, we want to figure out where we are in the world, right? How to navigate the world, what to do next, plan our day, plan our motions, actions, right? Make analysis, statistical analysis of patterns around us, etc. I mean, it's really just starting of artificial intelligence, like starting meaning, I mean, feeding the artificial intelligence with artificial vision. Okay. So now new norm is becoming, this was just past one, now it's past maybe 3-4 years, deep methods. We will look at a few of them in the later parts of the course, deep learning based methods. I said I require you have basic computer vision image processing knowledge. Here at this point, we were going to the syllabus, but we've already looked at the syllabus with you. And I was telling you about this test yourself basic assignments. This is really for you to test yourself, homework zero. I think I can, I will give this homework, like give you this, for instance, this picture. And I will ask you count the numbers or just tell me what the dice, what numbers are these dice. If you can, given this picture, just single picture, if you can output, write an algorithm that says there are three dice here and the numbers on the dice are this and that, then your vision skills are really good at a nice level for this course, okay? Because you see, we are not really doing 2D vision here. We are going beyond that. So I assume you guys mastered those skills. Okay? Guys, before we leave, any questions until this point? Are we fine? Please test yourself. Because by taking 3D vision this semester, I believe you guys really want to advance in this field, vision. So, I mean, you want to really go deep, because this is when people or students take this course, I assume they want to really become experts in visual data processing, right? Topic. So you have to check yourself whether you have these necessary basic skills, please, guys. Okay, and let me know during the week, because I think this is a drop week and you can evaluate yourself with this exercise. So we should give this homework today to Ninova, actually. Okay, now for instance, get these and then try to count, you know, those dots, but automatically. So before I leave for today, because today typically our first week is an introductory week, let me just give a very quick, guys. I will be quick here. You guys can check later if you are interested. A little bit history, how it started, 3D vision. 63, guys, 1963, Larry Roberts. And this guy is known as father of ARPANET. Very interesting, right? Internet. But actually his thesis was on, his PhD thesis at MIT was on 3D vision. He took these pictures and then did edge processing. You see 2D gradient operators. And from those, tried to come up with 3D models. Again, this is really, I'll just say a few sentences for each just to give you some pointers if you guys are into the history of this. But maybe, I mean, also it's good to know this guy who's known as the father of internet in a way, the pioneer. his PhD thesis was on vision. Then in 70s, people tried to use shading properties and use a single image like this one here, guys, to come up with a 3D surface on top of it. So belief was, you see bright points, they are well illuminated. This is actually starting of what we call a photometric stereo. So very bright points, they believed, for instance, the normal, surface normal at those points are more directed towards the camera, and the shading points here, like here, you see they are tilted. So they try to come up with surface normals, actually. Shape from shading tries to estimate the surface normals from a single image based on these shading properties. Shading meaning how the scene is illuminated. The bright points are well illuminated, faces the light directly. So surface normals should be more directly oriented, and the shaded parts are more oriented. I mean, however, this is a little bit vague and not very, I should say, stable or not reliable. It's not pursued a lot afterwards. But the reason historically it's important is this field, this line of work in 3D vision gave birth to photometric stereo, which is important. So what is it? This photometric stereo is to view a scene by actually different lightings. For instance, lights, again, you have a camera, but you have, for instance, three different, you move your light source, and then you try to recover the surface normals, okay? So three images, for instance, will be enough for you to give the 3D, to recover 3D structure. David Forsythe's book, section 224, guys, has a nice explanation. Maybe, let me see, we will be touching upon photometric stereo a little bit. And for instance, then, this is a nice recovery. This, again, statue was illuminated from different, you see light sources or different directions. You take its camera, I mean, its picture with your camera, and come up with actually a 3D representation. Here, what we're showing is actually the surface direction. When I say surface normal, it's the surface direction. This is a sphere, you see. It is, when it's, you see pink, actually surface normal points in that direction, right? Or cyan is in this direction. So it's really a coding, a mapping of the surface normals as a color map. So visualization is a huge field on its own, very fun field. And they come up with these compact, ingenious ways of actually visualization ideas. Why? Because we are really actually seeing things on a 2D view, right? 2D plane, because our devices are like 2D monitors, TV, like all these smart devices we have, they have 2D screens for now, guys. I believe in the future, as we see in the movies, it will be holograms. Like, I mean, I would really want to work with those. I really like envy those movies where you open up a hologram in front of you and you work with a 3D space, right, instead of our flat monitors. But currently we are confined to 2D. That's why we have to come up smart ways of visualizing, coloring, right? That's called also data visualization field. Another topic of its own, requires a course on its own. Then, like I said, photometric stereo comes, 1977. Of course, these are like the first ideas. Here, the idea, we will talk about this. We will look at basic photometry. What is photometry? We also assign some reflectance property to the surface. So there is geometry, right? There is geometry of the object from 3D to 2D when we take the picture. Also, there is light hitting the object and reflected. And also there is color, right? Of course, in the illumination. So that light is also utilized. And how it reflects and how we view the, for instance, this object from different viewpoints. If we assume, for instance, the light pattern doesn't change, that's the Lambertian surface, for instance. But if we believe when I look at this pattern from different viewpoints, that's a specular, like mirror-like object. To model those photometric properties of objects, there is something called bidirectional reflectance distribution function, BRDF. This is next, in the next weeks, I will talk about introductory level, of course, because this is a computer graphics topic, but we have to know the basics of it. They use those functions to recover also photometric properties of the surfaces, actually, guys. So let me, I think there was a video, that's why I'm going. They were using photometric stereo to capture Obama. Guys, I opened it for you just for us to see a demo, right? Let me see the demo, show the demo, the president in 3D. This is okay from 2014, but I think we should see an example like this. Can you see my screen, the video? Can you see it, guys? So, okay, so let's check it out. I can scroll if it's too much. Let's see, but it's a very nice illustration of photometric stereo. You will see all these different light sources and then creation of the 3D rendering. That's why I think it will solidify in your mind what I'm talking about.
It's called our mobile light stage. It's right over there, and we're setting it up right now so that it can be used to record almost certainly the highest resolution digital model that's ever been made of a head of state.
The inspiration for the project of creating a 3D portrait of President Obama really comes from the Lincoln Life Mask in our National Portrait Gallery. And I have a Lincoln Life Mask with me today, and they're called Life Masks because these were directly taken from his life. So they were put on his face. There were two little holes poked where the nostrils were so he could still breathe. And seeing it made us think, what would happen if we could actually do that with a sitting president using modern day technologies and tools to create a similarly authentic experience that connects us to history, to connect us to a moment in time, and connects us to a person's likeness.
So the process should go relatively quickly. We will invite the president to sit down. He will be surrounded in front by 50 custom-built LED lights, 8 high-resolution sports photography cameras, and an additional 6 wider-angle cameras. In about 1 second, as he holds his presidential pose, he'll be illuminated by 10 different lighting conditions, which will change the polarization of the light, the directionality of the light, will give us everything that we need to understand the shape of his face and how it transforms incident illumination into the images that we see of him. 10 years ago, it was just barely possible to think this could be done.
So here we have a structured light 3D scanner, and we're using this to scan the president. They're handheld, they're flashing a fringe pattern of light, and there are stereo cameras recording how that fringe pattern forms over geometry, or in this case, the president's face.
The president getting his likeness scan, as cool as that is also about a broader trend that's going on, and that is the third industrial revolution. It's the combination of the digital world and physical world that is allowing students and entrepreneurs to be able to go from idea to prototype and to both of them.
It's been a few days since we've 3D scanned the president, and we're looking at some raw data on screen right here. So this is the data that came out of the handheld scanners that Adam Mattel and I were using to scan the president.
This is the first bust that's created of a head of state from objective 3D scan data. So this isn't an artistic likeness of the president. This is actually millions upon millions of measurements that create a 3D likeness of the president that we can now 3D print and make something that's never been done before.
Yeah, that's done. You can also 3D print. Beautiful. Wow, that's really nice. I mean, okay. So that was really, guys, a great illustration of the 3D. I was telling you both, actually, they were also, there was active scanning there, right? Light projection and also photometric and geometric 3D reconstruction there going on. They said 50 cameras, right? I mean, it's really beautiful. high resolution 3D capture. I mean, I'm showing another country's president, but I think it's a great example for the technology. I mean, high resolution 3D capture. I think a beautiful video also. Okay, so there is also another interesting technology. You guys can check this that uses photometric stereo. This actually I can also show this. We are coming to an end, so I know, but I think this is all fun. So I maybe I should show that too. That's also this time for microscopic materials, guys. This is you press an object into a gel. I opened it up here, and let me see. There is sorry for the advertisement. So okay, it's a little bit fast, but maybe I can change the speed. It uses again lights, different lights, and then for instance now with the photometric stereo and 3D reconstruction, you can reconstruct things like your skin in very much detail, fibers and things. That's why I really liked this application, showing the potential or application of 3D vision, guys, in real life examples. I hope you guys also come up with inventions like this. This was a patented technology maybe from 10 years ago, gel site, or I don't know the exact date, but look at this. Look.
This is the 3D shape of the palm. Gelsite can resolve the overall shape as well as the fine details like the ridges of the hand. Gelsite can measure extraordinarily on the beam. Here we measure the T. It's both the rays printing and the fibers of the print. Currently, we can resolve features as small as
goodness. You can check maybe further things with Gelsite. It's beautiful. I mean, also a great application of, guys, really, this photometric stereo. Sends light, send again, takes pictures using those pictures of differently illuminated scene views, actually. You can create your 3D surface. So let me see, what else do we have? Use of photometric stereo. This was the paper or the first thing that came out about Gelsite. I think it's a great exemplar technology of use of photometric stereo. That's why I wanted to show it to you. And then there are, guys, other things like, for instance, shape from silhouettes, meaning you get the silhouettes of things. I mean, we won't be really going much into these, but let me maybe just finish in 5 minutes. I mean, we won't be able to cover everything. Of course, it's already quite a loaded content of this course, guys. So here it's really projecting these silhouettes back into 3D space and getting an intersection shape from silhouettes. So there is another field. These are the most early examples you see from 1974. There are like visual halls again. project all the silhouettes and getting these intersections in the 3D space, get a 3D shape. This is, I think, one of the, this 94 visual hall is one of the papers that you would want to read. It's a Transactions on Pattern Analysis and Machine Intelligence paper. I recall as a PhD student reading that and saying, wow, that's a great idea. But we will not go into details of these. Like I said, I mean, it's a huge field. These are more shaped from silhouettes or 3D volumetric processing type 3D vision. For us, actually, guys, I should say in the historical development, the main major landmark is 81 essential matrix. So I was talking to you about epipolar geometry. This essential matrix and fundamental matrix are the main actually developments which helped us to get these epipolar constraints and from there recover camera rotation and motion. You see, it started in 81. So we'll get a matrix that helps us encode pose of the camera actually in the view, which is excellent. This is, we won't be covering another type of 3D. I was telling you about, for instance, medical vision, volumetric things. This is now meshes. Okay, you go from point clouds to meshes, for instance, by marching cubes algorithm, volume to surface mesh. These are the topic of, guys, computational geometry field. That's again another huge field on its own. Okay. Okay, structure from motion by factorization, one of the early structure from motion methods. I mean, not that 3D vision really progressed very slowly. Those methods that I've been showing, these earlier methods, were successful up to a point, but were not really reliable, were not really that generalizable, or were not very computationally efficient. That's why I mean, I'm not really going into detail of each of these things. There is this method or field of space carving. This time you start with actually a block. It's really, this one works very good idea, like a sculptor. They start with a big marble, for instance, and start really getting things out of that, right? So here it's similarly like carve, you know, from the marble or whatever material they are working with to really extract or bring out the object they wanna express. Here it's the same idea by projecting from the views onto this actually 3D volume. They carve with respect to the consistency of these multiple views when actually they are on the 3D space. They carve the voxels. So in the end, those voxels that are not carved end up actually showing the object that was imaged actually, for instance. Then actually uncalibrated 3D or self-calibrated techniques. Now this is where now you have the camera calibration, intrinsic camera calibration, extrinsic camera calibration. So and bring all these together to come up with a 3D model, the surface texture map. This was bringing everything together. So there was a little bit more interest in 3D vision at the end of 90s and early 2000s. But still, it didn't catch the, you know, I could say, the expected interest. But now, for the past, I think I could say 5 years or so, it's also picked up with the help of these learning-based methods. So this was a little bit history. Currently, it's the more deep methods, like I said. That completes my introduction to you of the motivations of the field, the main problems of the field. I think we can just leave it here at this point, and I can ask you if you have questions. And I can maybe stop the recording also at this point, if it's okay. See you guys next time, let's say.